So I'm Bill the Brain Guy, and here to chat with you for a few minutes, the next few minutes, about interdisciplinary neuroscience and how it's going to shape our future. And I'm going to tell you three stories, basically three little vignettes, one about how neuroscience is affecting health, one about neuroscience and law issues, and a third one about neuroscience and its application to business and economics. So let's do health first. Many of you will be aware that President Obama announced the National Brain Initiative back in April. Those of us in neuroscience were actually quite startled by this. The federal science agencies have been busy planning how they're going to respond to this. And this was an article in the New York Times that appeared just about a week ago announcing that one agency will focus on advancing deep brain stimulation, which I'll call DBS. How many of you have heard of deep brain stimulation? I'm just curious. So it's a sizable minority. This agency, astoundingly, was not what you would think, the National Institutes of Health. It was DARPA, Defense Advanced Projects Research Agency. What in the world is DARPA doing getting involved in deep brain stimulation? What is deep brain stimulation, for that matter? You can think of deep brain stimulation as kind of like a pacemaker for some specific circuit in the brain. So an electrode is surgically implanted to a target in the brain, and you wear a pacemaker-like device in your chest that keeps that thing powered up and stimulating certain circuits in your brain 24/7, basically. And there's about 100,000 patients now worldwide that have had these implanted for Parkinson's disease. Experimentally, it's being used for treating really serious depression, OCD, essential tremor, and DARPA is interested in treating a number of refractory diseases that are having difficulty being dealt with by standard means. Well, this is pretty radical, right, to put electrodes in your brain. Why would you do that? So I'm going to give you this example. This is a woman, Sybil, a resident of Georgia, actually, the Atlanta area, who had this surgery. And I want to show you before, immediately after, and a bit after her surgery. So this is from Dateline, NBC News. This is a little shot with Sybil before the surgery.
Even a simple task like eating breakfast was a frustrating battle with her own body.
How can you live your life when you're shaking so much?
It's extremely difficult. Sometimes even overwhelming. And I get very emotional. Sometimes I cry. It's just a hard thing to do.
The disease had gotten so bad that sometimes her muscles froze completely, making her face almost expressionless, and her legs almost useless. The woman who once was always on the go could barely move, confined to a wheelchair.
So she then, here at Emory Medical School, actually had an electrode put in one side of her brain, and this is catching up with Sybil. This is 3 days after the surgery.
3 days after the operation, in a moment that would test Sybil's dreams.
Let's see how you do.
After 2 long years trapped in a wheelchair, would she finally be able to walk?
Right arm is swinging.
So the right arm swings, yeah.
I haven't swung my right arm for I don't know how long.
So you notice she swung the right arm, but not the left, because she only had the electrode on one side of her brain. So she had a second electrode put in the brain, and then they catch up with her about 4 months later.
A month after her second surgery, when we caught up with Sybil again.
So Sybil, how do you feel?
Great.
Remember that wheelchair? It was gathering dust in the garage. Doesn't have to.
Show me what can you do now that you couldn't do before?
Oh! Good heavens, look at that! Look at her! Look at that!
Sybil and Alvin had hoped for a lot from the surgery, but the outcome was better than they could have imagined.
So I have to tell you guys, in all honesty, this is a treatment for Parkinson's disease, but it is not a cure. So Parkinson's is caused when a certain pathway in your brain, dopaminergic cells, start dying for reasons that we still don't know. And first line of defense is a drug therapy, L-DOPA. Many of you probably know people who are on L-DOPA. But eventually, the amounts of drug that are necessary is just too much. And this is a treatment that you go to next. And it's a progressive disease. This doesn't cure it, but it can give somebody 2 to 3 years of their lives back when it works really well. And this is why DARPA is interested and why we're interested in starting to tune, basically fine-tune circuits in the brain when they get into unstable activity patterns. So let's talk just for a minute about law. Many of you, some of you in this audience are old enough to remember this guy, Charles Whitman, ex-Marine, undergraduate at the University of Texas. And he was the first of sort of the modern era of shooters. He's the guy who climbed into the tower at the center of University of Texas with a high-powered rifle and shot 31 people and in the end shot himself. And earlier in the day, he had killed his wife and his mother. And Charles Whitman actually kept a diary. He kept notes. And it's astounding, riveting reading. This is directly from his notes. I talked to a doctor once for about 2 hours and tried to convey to him my fears that I felt overcome by overwhelming violent impulses. After one session, I never saw the doctor again, and since then I've been fighting my mental turmoil alone and seemingly to no avail. After my death, I wish that an autopsy would be performed to see if there is any visible physical disorder. This is a guy who knew something was wrong, right? And then it was after much thought, this was actually a note I think that was found with his body. It was after much thought that I decided to kill my wife, Kathy, tonight. I love her dearly, and she has been as fine a wife to me as any man could ever hope to have. I cannot rationally pinpoint any specific reason for doing this. And then again, if my life insurance policy is valid, please pay off my debts, donate the rest anonymously to a mental health foundation. Maybe research can prevent further tragedies of this type. And sure enough, his brain was autopsied, and astoundingly, he had a tumor. And the tumor was in the amygdala, which is circled in red right there, which is a structure that we know is involved in the control of emotions and fine-tuning emotional expression. And it was actually impinging on the hypothalamus, which is also another major structure known to be involved in emotion. Now, this raises really important questions. Did that cause Whitman's behavior? We don't know, and we'll never know about Whitman, but we might know in the future. And the important questions are things like this. I mean, Whitman clearly was struggling at a rational level versus his emotional impulses, and we want to know how do these systems interact in the brain. We want to know in what situations can antisocial or criminal behavior be clearly attributed to brain dysfunction, and should this matter? Can neuroscience actually speak to the issue of personal responsibility for the law, or is it irrelevant to that issue? And ultimately, can neuroscience provide useful predictive data about the likelihood of repeat offenses? This is something that federal judges tell us would be most useful for neuroscience to do if we can give any objective data about whether someone's likely to be a repeat offender in the future. So let's talk about business and economics for a moment. I trust most of you realize that when God's reaching out to touch Adam's finger and breathe life into him, he's doing it from inside a brain. You see that? This might start a new field, a neurotheology field. I don't know. We could find out about that. But in business and in many walks of life, we really want to know why do people make the decisions they make? Can we get better at predicting and influencing those decisions? And finally, how can we make better decisions, right? So there are a lot of people who would like to know more about this. Advertisers would love to know what's going on in your brain in order to sell you tacos. In order to get you to vote for someone they're representing, or to get you to listen to really socially progressive public health and public welfare announcements. There are current tools that you have to predict the success of these campaigns that are limited and often unreliable. So people depend a lot on their experience that's accumulated over careers. They depend heavily on self-reports from focus groups. And of course, they just give it a try sometimes and see whether it's a spectacular success or whether it flops. And here in Atlanta, some of you will remember this one, right? This is one of the biggest flops in advertising history. And the point is, these things cost a lot of money, and you don't know until the end. So neuromarketing, which is a new field that I'm sure many of you have heard about, wants to dig deeper than this. There are firms that are actually making brain activity measurements now while people scan advertising displays or move through stores. There are other people who are simply trying to measure attention, the brain's attentional system, using the eyes as a proxy for attention. So where do the eyes point when they stand in front of a display? That's a tracking of where a person's eyes point on that photograph of a woman. And there's other people looking at trying a facial expression analysis, so taking pictures of people's faces when they face some sort of display or a computer screen and analyzing what emotions are going on in there. Now, this field is still in its infancy, but really when you get right down to it, when you're a microeconomist or you're trying to predict the outcome of political campaigns or you're trying to sell something, what you really care about is decisions, decisions to buy, decisions to change your behavior, et cetera. And the notion is that brain activity measurements combined with behavioral measurements will be able ultimately to tell us whether certain messages are tapping in well to attention systems, memory systems in the brain, emotional engagement, and subconscious associations, and then allow us to better predict how decisions are going to be influenced. So can we ultimately do this? Can we get better at predicting and influencing decisions? The answer is maybe. If we know more about what is going on in the brain, maybe we can increase our predictive power. So this is why we've started the Stanford Neurosciences Institute. This, as John Hennessy said earlier, is going to be across the campus. It's going to include multiple schools, multiple departments, multiple topics. And this has just been a little taste, but if any of you want to dig deeper into the actual science behind this, come to my breakout session later and we'll dive deep. Thank you.
All right. Thank you.